in this world.
I love that.
It's impossible to become successful unless you have an environment that supports you.
Coolest invention ever. Submit your fun invention and you could win $250,000. Go to mydreamvention.com for more details.
I would definitely not allow anyone to come into my locker room while I'm getting changed. Considering this was a major match at WrestleMania and the legacy was as strong as ever on this night, I'm actually surprised that Ted DiBiase and Cody Rhodes did not make any appearances whatsoever in Randy's match.
Thank you, Texas!
2.5 minutes of a boring promo from JBL. Also, it takes literally 7 minutes before the match begins following the introductions.
This is the greatest day in JBL's life.
Something tells me he's going to get annihilated in less than a minute.
I would return to Texas, champion.
Actually, you said you wanted to return to Texas as World Heavyweight Champion. You specifically stated which title you wanted to hold.
You know, the whole situation that Shawn Michaels ever started this year.
I will give you the most dominant victory.
JBL just spoiled this match. Thanks a lot, man. Well, I have to admit, that Joker costume is very well put together.
You played as a Joker? I think the race for his body welcome.
Well, I'm throwing in 10 sins right there. I know JR said that by accident, but I don't give a shit.
Adding in, I think Ray's career is alive and well following Jerry saying Heath Ledger's Joker is disrespectful.
In New York City, he is the...
All right, welcome to the
Young Turks. Ring announcers don't say how much a certain wrestler weighs. Like JBL and Shawn Michaels, the only exception, in my opinion, to not announce the weight of the wrestler during introductions to the women.
Some of my favorite clips here are... Why my old friend Ted Cruz with Gorsuch, and how
and
smart
now?
He is. You're gonna love it. You're absolutely gonna love it.
Also,
and there's so many good stories here. What else do I have for you guys?
This is a good championship match.
You're gonna be shocked at which party he comes from, and then. Manafort. I have a declaration on Manafort.
Years as a commentator instead
official
of a wrestler,
Russian agent. And that is literally, and we will explain. I believe he should be in prison.
No wrestling match or WrestleMania has ever been perfectly executed the way this one
whether
has.
Whether it relates to Trump
that.
Is a really interesting question.
No match
question.
Has ever been better
slightly
than
different
this.
Question.
Not even
so we'll get to that a little bit later in the
mainly
program.
Due to Undertaker's leg injury.
Lots of exciting news. Speaking of exciting news, I want to tell you guys, we're almost at 1.5 million. Can I get that at JesusTorkNetwork.com/show?
No greater truth than that.
So, what I'm going to do is I'm going
to
show you a picture of two of the people
top
who might be hired.
Of Shawn Michaels, mainly because of the meaning of this entrance.
Then
Shawn
might
portrays an angel
tonight,
descending from heaven, while Undertaker portrays a demon rising from
hell. I don't
hell.
Know, I'm just saying.
This entrance
okay.
combined with Undertaker's is worth a removal of 5 cents.
494. Can I see?
So close.
And
can I see one point in
because I love how Undertaker just
the
cuts off Shawn's music instead of the usual 1 minute wait.
Can you hear me graphic 23 inches? Two out of the three are in this
qualification, and Shawn was attacking Undertaker for
picture.
Longer than the 5 count.
Oh, no,
but the referee
pixelated.
Stopped
That's
at 3 for some stupid
oh
reason.
Oh my god, who are they? Who are they?
They're in the foreground. What was the point of Undertaker just
okay.
pausing for 5 seconds instead of attacking?
He didn't really
take
okay,
any
anyway,
damage from Shawn at all early on in the match, so
show.
Why
go.
The boss?
Literally, in that case. Okay, speaking of going,
Shawn
we start with disaster
from school,
yes, we do.
The Undertaker didn't even connect at all. Take your pick.
A terror attack has occurred near the British Parliament, leaving 4 individuals dead. Now, the story is still developing, but there are some details that we do know at the moment. It was an attack outside the Parliament on Wednesday that left 4 people dead and injured 20 and prompted
like
the evacuation of the
does.
Prime Minister.
What does Shawn
have
against
now,
the original figure
this
for?
Occurred when someone decided to mow through a crowd of people near
know,
the Parliament, and the driver of a large vehicle mowed down pedestrians on Westminster Bridge, which leaves Parliament, killing 2 people and injuring others. Now, of course, the death toll has increased since the New York Times reported on the story.
Completely.
Before crashing into a railing, after the crash, at least one man left the vehicle, that's the suspect, and approached Parliament, where he stabbed an armed police officer to death and was fatally shot.
You just ruined that line, Michael.
So the suspect
is
dead as of now, and as I mentioned, it is a developing story, so we don't know many details about the suspect other than the fact that he has been killed by police officers.
What the fuck was that?
So, whatever you were in the first 24 hours.
Jesus,
you don't have complete information.
Ribs, a possible
authorities in the UK say they are relatively
right
confident that it was
I'm
only
sure
one attacker.
To continue after that is beyond
so they
me. But its moments where determination is beyond impressive that makes this match so
of course, wondering if it's an ISIS-related attack.
Taking a power nap in the ring.
Claim responsibility, but it is their MO to use cars.
It's been over a minute since
over
Sean
people,
made that jump.
France, Germany, and other European countries where they've done that.
Neck is definitely
this
broken
case,
right now. That was one of the scariest dives I've ever seen in the nearly 18 years I've watched
year
wrestling. I legit thought Undertaker had been seriously
so
hurt.
Very, very
it's
likely
amazing
to be
that,
that,
like Sean, Undertaker
so right now
was
we don't
able
know
to get back up and continue to put on the most perfect match in WWE.
But it would be fairly shocking.
Also, the referee barely hit the barricade at all, and yet he is
related to those earlier terror attacks, which was at least inspired by ISIS. And ISIS
this
usually gives directions on how to carry out lone wolf attacks,
of match,
meaning that there might not be
any
communication with ISIS.
Many of us thought it'd be impossible that he would be able to re-enter the ring.
If you're going
to
do it, the way you should do it is X, Y, and Z.
You need 7
and
or 8.
Involves,
it's obvious that the referee's count is at 7.
People over with,
you need to say 4 or 8, unless 7 is super
right. I like that you made that clarification, because due to all the terror attacks that have occurred over the last few years in European countries like France and Belgium,
that is a
it's much more difficult for organized terror plots to happen. A lot of authorities will they're able to essentially figure out that there's a planned terrorist attack and prevent it before it happens. But these lone wolf attacks are more likely to happen because while they might be ISIS inspired, it's harder to track them. Right? So that's what we're seeing in this case, at least as it seems now with the details that we have.
See,
again, we don't have
right
all the details yet. It is a developing story, so we'll find
out
all the details later.
Okay, so the British authorities
right
actually have been excellent
out of the stopping
terror attacks.
Was rare and
in the last
extremely shocking moment. These days, everybody
overall
expects the
The ones
out
that are the hardest to stop
WWE
are the ones that are not
coordinated.
When someone gets
like
it in their crazy head
to do
this,
all the time
and
now
they don't communicate with anyone, including ISIS. So that's why ISIS might also be, quote-unquote, late in
right
taking responsibility, because they didn't realize it was happening. Again, we don't know that for sure yet. It's the first 24 hours.
Almost
but, you know, ISIS had this family that was interesting, which is attack
everyone
at once, almost everyone. And then we'll have a world attention, and that will
later,
draw
no more
allies to us and the people who are on our side, and we'll get more Muslims to become radical and engage in this fight.
Music.
In the beginning,
first
it seemed to be working,
a
and they took a lot of territory
to
and they were
running towards
now
shot.
We're at the
that
downside,
no
of that, which is they're attacking everyone,
secondly,
and everyone is attacking
sweet music.
And so this might be in also in retaliation, and because they are worried about the attack against their capital, which is in Raqqa, Syria. So as
but you can't
troops
deny
are
that this match was
starting
one of the
to
best,
bear down on Raqqa,
the most
this is ISIS lashing out.
Match in WrestleMania.
It might
every
not. It's overall not good news for them.
The end
and this is a long-term consequence
of
their actions. So
the shock,
you know, they
scary
they,
moments as well.
Apparently,
for the first time ever,
they or
I am deducted 100 cents to one event just because
four
of this
people
match.
Here in the UK.
Also, I'm not saying
but
this point, but some of you are
more numbered
that the same counter did shatter in this case. Well, the reason for that is because the other sense
is
shattered
might
because
be
it had less than 100
violent
cents, and that's the maximum limit
of
sins being removed off this channel.
Overly violent.
Learn something new every day.
Terrorist group
and to be
quite
honest, this
in
match should have been the main event,
violent,
as this would have been the perfect
ISIS
ending
records,
to WrestleMania 25.
But
the remaining two matches did very well, but definitely
I
did not
completely agree with you.
Through.
At the same time, you know, the U.S. needs to be careful with its own foreign policy, and so this is a separate story, but I think it's also important to mention it.
There was
recently a U.S.-led mission in Syria, and that mission ended with 33 civilians in a shelter for displaced Syrians dying. Right, so 33 civilians lost their lives as a result. These are people that we need on our side. And so we need to be careful not to target civilians or to ensure that we're not accidentally, if it was an accident, attacking shelters that are housing innocent individuals who want no part of
the
violence. So no one's talking about that, and I understand why we value certain lives more than others. But again, 33 innocent civilians in Syria, as they were in a shelter, were killed due to a U.S. mission.
Blah, 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 the way John Cena does lie.
So that doesn't help the situation at all. And
But didn't the commentators just say that show weighed 485 pounds, or were they just being sarcastic?
And there's plenty of civilians who died under President Obama as well.
Yes.
We do know that this current president drags
in WrestleMania 25 to bring in those two different episodes of Monday Night Raw, where show did the exact same thing.
We'll see how it plays out, but obviously tragic on both ends of that.
It's the second possible broken tailbone that we've seen tonight.
An investigation has uncovered that Paul Manafort, Trump's former campaign chairman from March to August of 2016, had very cozy ties to a very wealthy businessman in Russia who had a cozy relationship with Vladimir Putin. Now, the Associated Press reported the details of Manafort's business relationship with this individual in Russia and how it could potentially lead to some criminal charges against him because of the fact that he didn't follow the law in disclosing this relationship. So let me give you the details on that. Paul Manafort secretly worked for a Russian billionaire to advance the interests of Russian President Vladimir Putin a decade ago and proposed an ambitious political strategy to undermine anti-Russian opposition across former Soviet republics. Specifically, Manafort proposed in a confidential strategy plan as early as June 2005 that he would influence politics, business dealings, and news coverage inside the United States, Europe, and former Soviet republics to benefit the Putin government. So I'm going to stop right there. We actually have emails that Manafort had written, email correspondence showing, you know, what his strategy was and how he planned on working to, you know, garner up favor towards Vladimir Putin. It doesn't look good, and for the first time, we actually have some solid evidence of the ties that people in the Trump camp had with Russia.
That was one of the coolest sentences of the night. Manafort was lying about his relationship with Russia. He claimed that he did not have
We have proof of him completely denying it. Let's take a look at video number two.
It was awesome seeing JR drink with Steve. I still got to send him for a drink and not the job.
To be clear, Mr. Trump has no financial relationships with any Russian oligarchs. So, look, to be clear, that question was Trump specifically and whether or not he had ties to anyone in Russia.
It was just a world title celebration.
It's just so obvious in how he's lying. And so we have more details about what he did for Vladimir Putin, but jump in there.
Two things that he's lying about. One is his relationship. And secondly, about Trump's relationship. He tried to be lawyerly there and give the exact right answer without lying. It didn't work. It was super obvious. And by the way, that is a question about Trump's financial dealings. So that's a much more weighty question. But now, let's move on to Trump Manafort's ties, which is that Manafort was his campaign chairman, the very top of the campaign. The only person higher than the campaign chairman is the candidate himself. So now they're trying to distance themselves from Manafort, but that is nonsense. And after you hear all the evidence, I would suggest to you that Paul Manafort should be in prison. I'm not kidding. He's a Russian agent. And so,
she doesn't know she should go back to her seat.
All right, so Manafort pitched the plans to Russian aluminum magnate Oleg Deripaska, a close Putin ally with whom Manafort eventually signed a $10 million annual contract beginning in 2006, according to interviews with several people familiar with payments to Manafort and business records obtained by the Associated Press. Manafort and Deripaska maintained a business relationship until at least 2009.
Now, the Associated Press does not know the final number. They only know the information they have access to. And they have access to multi-million-dollar money or checks going across the wire. Okay? So they know there was multi-million dollars. They know that it was the contract was set to be $10 million a year. If it was from 06 to 09, that would be $40 million. And that gives you a lot of incentive to be a foreign agent. Now, what does it mean to be a foreign agent? It just simply means that you're working for a foreign government, which, by the way, a lot of people do. But you have to register and let the American government know that you are a foreign agent. So
what if he did bring up
that means, hey, I am. You raise your hand and say, I am lobbying for this group. I'm doing it for political reasons. So Manafort never did. did that and received a giant amount of money that he clearly, in some ways, hit, and he did not do it under the umbrella group that was public-facing, that he normally lobbied and did it under another name, so another way that he was trying to hide his giant pay.
Exactly, and what he was doing essentially worked against the best interests of America. So let me give you the details on an email that he had written. In regard to how he planned on helping Putin and how he wanted to garner support from Putin in the West. So he says, we are now on the belief that this model can greatly benefit the Putin government if employed at the correct levels with the appropriate commitment to success. The effort will be offering a great service that can refocus both internally and externally the policies of the Putin government, essentially allowing the policies of the Putin government to influence the policies of other countries, mainly the United States.
So, didn't I agree? That is very clear evidence in an email written by Manafort that he did, in fact, work for the Putin government. Something he has denied all along, and something that he absolutely had to register with the U.S. government. That is breaking clear laws as not registering with a foreign agent. And he's doing it through $10 million payments to a Russian oligarch. A Russian oligarch that is deeply tied to Putin goes on almost every business and foreign trip with him. And clearly, in the emails, there's no hiding it. He's not saying, hey, I'm doing this for your aluminum
business.
He's saying, I'm doing it for Putin government interests, internally meaning the Russia, externally meaning former Soviet republics, Central Asian countries, European countries, and yes, the U.S.
Yep.
So if you, and by the way, doing that is not necessarily illegal. But you have to register and say you're a foreign agent. If you don't do that, then it is illegal and you belong in prison.
Right. So, again, just to clarify how comfortable or how cozy the relationship is between this oligarch and Vladimir Putin, the Associated Press reports that U.S. diplomatic cables from 2006 described this oligarch as among the 2 to 3 oligarchs Putin turns to on a regular basis and a more or less permanent fixture on Putin's trips abroad. Also, keep in mind that Manafort proposed extending his existing work in Eastern Europe to Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, and Georgia, where he pledged to bolster the legitimacy of governments friendly to Putin and undercut anti-Russian figures through political campaigns, nonprofit front groups, and media operations. And by the way, he worked closely with individuals in Ukraine to essentially help Russia in their annexation of Crimea. And so,
that's against U.S. interests. So, Paul Manafort, working as a Russian foreign agent, literally, technical definition of that word, and this is, by the way, not when he was with the Trump campaign, so let's be clear about that. I'm going to get to his role in the Trump campaign in a minute, okay? Working as a Russian foreign agent, never reports to the U.S., working against U.S. interests in most of those countries, especially the Ukraine, and doing it in secret and lying about it throughout. Okay, those are heavy charges, and now with the internal emails, pretty much corroborated. It is corroborated. Now, whether he will spend time in prison is a matter that has to be adjudicated, I hope, in a court of law. I hope that they bring him to trial for hiding his true allegiance, which was not to the U.S. government. To give you a sense of how important, and why? Why do they hire Manafort, right? So why do they give him $10 million a year, $40 million overall if he got the full contract? Well, he not only worked on Trump's campaign, he also worked on McCain's campaign back in 2008. And that was in this time period. So they have bought themselves an agent that is as close to the power in this country as you can possibly get, works at the highest levels of different Republicans running for president, and then works those guys over to have pro-Russian policies. Now, he was the campaign manager for Donald Trump, who winds up becoming president. And what does Donald Trump have? Enormously pro-Russian policies that undercut our earlier American positions.
That's right.
So now you can say that's a coincidence, are people that naive? This guy, and I'm again, this is about Manafort, not about Trump. That Manafort gets $40 million from the Russians at some point, let alone later work that he did in 2014 again for the Russians in Ukraine. That's a whole different story in another time that he worked for the Russians, and then he happens to tell Trump, oh, you should have all these pro-Russian policies. You think that's a coincidence? Nobody in their right mind thinks that that's a coincidence.
Right. So, naturally, look, there is an investigation into Trump and his ties or potential ties to Russia and Vladimir Putin. And I hope that the following question is asked as a result of the Associated Press unearthing this information. How is it that Manafort ended up being the campaign chair?
That's a
right?
great question.
So I want to know how, why. Why is he the campaign chair? And then here's the follow-up question to that. So Manafort had a cozy relationship with this oligarch who paid him tens of millions of dollars until something happened a couple years ago. So a few years ago, Manafort was given about $19 million to start a media company that would push all of these ridiculous ideas, right? And so Manafort pocketed the money and then didn't do anything. He didn't start the media company at all. And so that's when the relationship between Manafort and this oligarch soured. And so they were aggressively going after Manafort for this money until Trump got elected. And then when Trump got elected, they just decided, it's all right. We're just going to let this go.
That's super interesting, and it can actually cut in two different directions. So when you're looking at it for Trump, so this Manafort guy is unbelievable. He appears to be a very serious criminal. So here's what I mean by that. This guy's, he, not only did he get all the money from the Russian oligarchs for all those years, and then he appears to rip them off to the point where a Russian oligarch makes a public display of it by having to sue him in the Cayman Islands. That happens in 2014, because in that deal, which was for the Black Sea Cable, he was supposed to start a TV company. They sent him the $19 million, and then they never hear from them again. Like, they email him, hey, what happened to the $19 million? Did you start the cable company? And he never responds to them again. He appears to have just pocketed the $19 million.
Yeah.
I mean, this guy's got some nerve on him. So you might say, hey, maybe that's when they cut off relations, and then Trump hired him several years later, and so that you could say maybe it's not related to Trump in that sense. Or, as Anna pointed out, well, Paul, there is a way that you can get right with the Russian oligarchs and not pay them that money back, get inside the Trump team, and make sure that they're okay with us taking Crimea, make sure they lift the sanctions that are worth $500 billion with ExxonMobil, etc. Now, that part is not yet proven, but under these circumstances, should clearly be deeply investigated.
Right. It's just all very strange. And again, he was supposed to start that media company in 2014. So it wasn't that long ago. Early in 2016, during the presidential campaign, the oligarch's representatives openly accused Manafort of fraud and pledged to recover the money from him. After Trump earned the nomination, the oligarch's representatives said they would no longer discuss the case. So I think that that's a strange thing that should be investigated. Again, all we can do right now is speculate, and so please don't take anything I say too seriously because it's speculation. But an investigation needs to take place. Thankfully, it is being taken. It is taking place, and hopefully they ask the right questions and look into all of these issues.
So let me explain again. This is our third time clarifying what is and is not speculation. So it is not speculation that Manafort worked for the Russians. It is Manafort's own words that he said, I work for the Putin government, and I am looking to help him with his policies internally and externally. It is not speculation that it is a violation of the law. Let me read you graphic 13 here. Under the Foreign Agents Registration Act, people who lobby in the U.S. on behalf of foreign political leaders or political parties must provide detailed reports about their actions to the department. And if they don't, that prison sentence can be up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Which, by the way, is honestly not much.
I mean, if you've already taken $40 million this time and $19 million another time, and let alone all the things we don't know about Manafort and how much more he took for the Ukraine job, yes, $250,000 is no big deal. 5 years in prison, that is a big deal. And so I'm looking forward to that happening. The speculation part is, how much does Trump know? And we don't know that yet. Newt Gingrich goes out there and says, now Trump should say he didn't know anything about that. Now Newt doesn't know that Trump didn't know anything about that, but he goes on and talks to the media and says, now the thing to say here is, you didn't know anything about it, and once you did, you fired him right away. And besides which, the administration is claiming, Manafort, what name so?
That's right. So they're, of course, trying to distance themselves as much as possible from Manafort. During a press conference, Sean Spicer did exactly that, or attempted to, even though a lot of people scoffed at it, including White House officials. Let's go to graphic 10. So Sean Spicer said Monday that Manafort played a very limited role for a very limited amount of time in the campaign. He was the campaign chair okay, for several months, from March to August of 2016. That is not a limited time. That is a very pivotal time in an election. And so even though his campaign chairman, he led it during the crucial run-up to the Republican National Convention.
So let me explain that more. So March to August, it involved 18 primary contests, including when he clinched in Indiana. First person he thanked was Paul Manafort, Trump. Okay, and then all the way to the Republican National Convention. Now you say, in March to August, that's not even a full year. The campaign is not that much longer. Remember, it starts in January, officially starts in January with the Iowa caucus, and goes till November. March through August is most of that time period. So now, unofficially, it started a little bit while before that, but it is a giant chunk of the campaign that this Russian agent was running Trump's campaign. So we know now that a Russian agent was running Trump's campaign, and by the way, all the people telling me that there was no evidence of Russia and Trump connections. What happened now? Okay, it looks like there's evidence. Now, to what degree Trump knows, we don't know, but from him backpedaling to Manafort, a very limited role, very limited time, total and utter nonsense, in a gigantic role for the most pivotal time. They're like, oh, he only worked till August. Well, what does that leave? September, October?
Yeah.
It only leaves basically 2 months before the election in the beginning of November.
And also, in Trump's perfect world, where evidence clears him and he really didn't know about Manafort's cozy ties to Vladimir Putin, it's inconceivable that Manafort, who's obviously very pro-Russia, didn't influence Donald Trump in any way or influence the campaign in any way to be more pro-Russia as a result of his cozy ties to Vladimir Putin, right? So, I don't know, Donald Trump might be completely innocent, but we know that he's not the smartest person in the world, not the sharpest tool in the shed. So, is he easily impressionable? Absolutely. And so, if this guy is in the campaign, he's a campaign chair, and he's very pro-Russia, he might have had an impact there.
Yeah, I mean, Trump's best case scenario is, hey, remember, I'm a total moron, so I got played by this guy, and I couldn't tell that he was a Russian agent, so he got me to do every single thing that Russia wanted, but I thought it was for the best. I was too stupid to figure out that he's actually working for the Russians. So that's his best defense. Now, last thing on this is an interesting side note here. When you look at the emails on how he was trying to get positive policies, whether in favor of the Putin government, whether it was here in the U.S. or Uzbekistan or in Ukraine or anywhere else, he would go pay off legal experts at universities, including here, Duke University, NYU, etc. He would go fund people that worked at scholars that worked at think tanks, and they would come up with fake, I'm sure they claim, no, these are real things as to why Putin is right, and the Russian interests are so wonderful. But in reality, they're getting paid by Manafort, and Manafort's getting paid by a Russian oligarch. And he works the media. So these guys are all connected in the Washington circles, and they do this in other countries, and they do this kind of propaganda right here in America. So they go work their friends in the media, in academia, and the so-called think tanks. The think tanks are almost completely useless. They're all propaganda outlets on the left or the right.
Except for our think tank here on TYT Network.
Which is on YouTube.com / think tank. That's completely different. Can you imagine if Manafort was funding that? Anyway, believe me, we have no funding for that. Anyway, so that's how they do propaganda. So the next time you see something in the press or through a think tank, ironically, think twice about it, because probably somebody paid for it. Okay, all right, we got to take a quick break here. When we come back, the Gorsuch hearings. Are the Democrats fighting back enough? And the smarmy Cruz interaction with Gorsuch that you will love when we return.
Thank you. I'm super excited because we have different levels of members. They pay $10 a month, but there are some members that pay a little more. Executive producers, for instance. My favorite thing about executive producers is that we have quarterly calls with them. I love that I'm getting a little transparency and I'm knowing what you guys like and dislike. Ideas on how to improve the show, topics that maybe we haven't heard of yet and you really want us to cover. We have so much respect for you because of the fact that you keep us independent and allow us to be uncensored, unfiltered, without worrying about corporate sponsors breathing down our necks and telling us what we can and can't say. So if you want to be a member, obviously no pressure. You can go ahead and join by going to tytnetwork.com/join. I'm going to ask some uncomfortable questions. The first topic that I said that we would discuss a little more is masturbation.
And then I was swimming in a hazelnut river.
Are you sure you're not doing mushrooms? Oh my god, I can achieve an orgasm by myself.
Fuck that, I am going to talk about it, because there should be no shame. I think a lot about that, because I love life.
That openness led to amazing.
And I keep saying to everybody, oh, I gotta go call my wife. I figured that was a good excuse, and people can't say, hey, don't call your wife.
I'm going to release the rest.
It's so weird because at that moment I felt good and it smelled like lavender.
At the end, you get to go check. Nice job. If you're a member of the Young Turks, you too will rock the world. Turks, let me read a couple of tweets here at hashtag TYT Live. Angelica Shorty says, I think it's official, I'm addicted to TYT.
Mm.
Staying late at work so I don't miss you guys during the commute. Hubby won't be happy. I love it, Angelica. I love it. By the way, if you're a member, you could not only stream it whenever you want, you can download it and then watch it during your commute. I'm not saying anything, I'm just saying tytnetwork.com/join. That, of course, wouldn't be live. Keeping it real. Live, you either watch or don't watch, but right after the show's over or close to thereafter, if you're a member, you can download it anytime you want. Okay, Ben Peck says, Manafort sounded like me lying to my mom the first time she found some of my browsing history as a teenager.
Damn. Damn.
I am not the browsing, but porn, no, but okay.
I love how Ben Peck just, like, completely admitted to, like, browsing questionable stuff.
Well, I mean, like, I mean, everyone does. Who are we kidding, right? Anyway, Tennessee Badger says, given the way Trump doesn't run his businesses, I wouldn't say this means he knew, but it's definitely a great reason to investigate. I think that's exactly right. Nobody's exactly convinced that he knew what was going on because he's such a knucklehead. Okay. TYTnetwork.com/go. $27 from Keaton in Oregon. $31 from Catherine in the United Kingdom. $222 from Seabrook in California. Can I see where we are right now?
You guys are unbelievable. You're unbelievable.
1.5 million. We crossed the barrier there. Now, look, there's an official way that we're going to announce things, so I can't do it right now. But we will be doing it very soon, obviously, at a worst-case scenario on Friday. But I'm going to try. We're trying really hard to make sure we can announce it by tomorrow. And like I said, you're going to love these three names, this time three guys that we're going to share with you. And let's keep it going. There's only about 38 days or so left till the first 100 days of Trump. And by the way, no, there's only two cameras taken so far. There's like five, six cameras in the studio that you can name after yourself. And then we call those cameras by your name. We put your name on them for a long time, as we did with the studio crew. This desk is still available to be named for $10,000. The chairs, this is the Nick Wilde chair from the old studio build. How cool would it be to be, have the Ben Peck desk at TYT headquarters?
We're calling you out, Ben Peck.
I'm just saying, okay?
Calling you out.
Try to explain that to your mom. Mom, I kind of put $10,000 on the credit card. No, I'm kidding. Don't do anything you can't afford, for God's sake. But we do appreciate you supporting real journalism in this country. All right, what's next, Anna?
All right. The Senate Judiciary Committee is hearing all of the answers that Supreme Court nominee Neil Gorsuch has in regard to their questions. And, of course, this is the confirmation hearing, and it's important that he convince the Democrats to vote for him because we need at least 8 Democrats to vote in his favor in order for him to get confirmed. But, of course, Democrats are holding out because they're still pretty upset about what happened with Merrick Garland, who was President Obama's nominee to replace Antonin Scalia. Now, Mitch McConnell is probably the best part about all of this because he doesn't understand that, hey, you know, if you act like a dick, then maybe people are going to act like a dick in response to you being a dick, right? So let's take a look at what he had to say about Democrats holding out on Neil Gorsuch.
And yet, I haven't seen a single Democrat, unless they're one you've observed, indicate they were prepared to either vote for cloture or to vote for him. Leading you to ask the following question, if Judge Gorsuch can't achieve 60 votes in the Senate, could any judge appointed by a Republican president be approved with 60 or more votes in the Senate? If they don't find Gorsuch acceptable, are they taking the position that the vacancy should never be filled? At all? Last year they were complaining about there being a vacancy for roughly a year.
Yeah, they were complaining that there was a vacancy for roughly a year because you guys refused to even hear Merrick Garland out, have a hearing for him, right? You guys didn't want to play ball. What makes you think the Democrats are going to turn around and just play ball?
Is there no one to ask the question of, have you no shame? Like, you're the guy who said that you would block any justice under Obama indefinitely. Now you're turning around pretending to be outraged that the Democrats are not blocking it. They're just not voting in favor of him. They have no obligation to vote in favor of him or to vote in favor of cloture. And he's like, how dare they even delay this for 1 minute when you delayed it for a year?
Not only did they they delay it for a year, remember, during the election, no one, including Republicans, expected Donald Trump to win. And so they assumed that Hillary Clinton was going to win and become the next president, and that she would be able to nominate a judge. And guess what Republicans said about a potential Hillary nominee? Take a look.
If Judge Gorsuch can't achieve 60 votes in the Senate, could any judge appointed by a Republican president be approved with 60 or more votes in the Senate?
I promise you that we will be united against any Supreme Court nominee that that Hillary Clinton, if she were president, would put up. And I promise you.
Last year, they were complaining about there being a vacancy for roughly a year.
Senator Cruz, he did talk about this last week in Colorado, and he said there's a long precedent for there being less than the 9 justices we've become accustomed to.
Are they taking the position that the vacancy should never be filled? At all?
If Hillary Clinton becomes president, I'm going to do everything I can do to make sure that 4 years from now, we've still got an opening on the Supreme Court. Good.
So when Republicans do it, they're strong, right? But when Democrats refuse to vote for a nominee that they might not even agree with, what's wrong with that? What's wrong with that? If they can't vote for him, they're not going to vote for anyone.
So I'm not surprised that the Republicans are breaking records on hypocrisy, and they don't care. They lie through their teeth. They do it all the time. They're doing it brazenly in this context. What annoys me is the press. So it is not objective to say Republicans say this and the Democrats say that. It is objective to point out that the Republicans are giant hypocrites on this. On different issues, you can have different opinions. On this, you just saw it for yourself. They said that they would not, they threatened to never allow a Hillary Clinton nominee. You just heard it with your own ears. So now for McConnell to say that he's outraged that the Democrats won't vote in favor of a nominee that they completely disagree with, and for the press to treat that even, like, oh, I can't tell who's right, who's wrong. No, your headline should say Republicans are hypocritical on this issue. I know for the press, they're like, heart attack, oh my God, that would be factual, I can't do that. It would seem biased to point out that they are wrong. It's not biased, it's factual. It's factual. Do your goddamn job. So, now, can the Democrats actually do anything about Gorsuch? Well, yeah, they could actually filibuster him, and very likely they will. Schumer says all you need is one Democratic senator to call for it, and then you're going to need 60 votes. That's technically a filibuster. My guess is that Bernie Sanders could probably raise his hand, among others. Okay, and since this is an easy political issue for the Democrats, probably all the guys who are angling for the presidency will raise their hands even before Bernie Sanders. So it's a layup in this case. So now McConnell says, no, I would like to keep the filibuster, but he will be confirmed by April 8th, period. Mm-hmm. Meaning, if they filibuster, I'm just going to get rid of the filibuster.
Right.
Now, all those years the Democrats were in power, oh my God, the filibuster, oh, it's so important. We got to let the Republicans block everything we do. The minute the Republicans are in power, April, that's like a couple of weeks from now. They're like, oh, there's a guy up, and if you guys don't do exactly what we tell you to do, within 2 weeks we'll kill this filibuster that you protected for decades and decades and decades, and we pretended was really important, and that we thought was an important part of Senate tradition, history, yada, yada. We're lying! We're Republicans. We don't care. We will immediately shred all the rules, do whatever the hell we want. And the Democrats, you will bow your goddamn heads.
And they will. That's the problem. They will bow their goddamn heads, right? And it's the case with pretty much everything. You see the hypocrisy with everything. The second Republicans are in power, the second Donald Trump gets elected, what does he do? One executive order after another, one executive action after another, which is what Obama was criticized for like crazy. But the criticism is all BS, right? It's the same thing that they want to do, except they want to do it 10 times more. And so that's what's happening with, the Senate hearings. And they're look, Republicans are incredibly strong compared to Democrats. And unfortunately, there's strength in a moral way and strength in an immoral way. They're strong in an immoral way. They don't care about hypocrisy. They don't care about the fact that they're lying because they know the media isn't going to cover them in a negative fashion. They know that they're going to, you know, get the media neutrality that you can enjoy on networks like CNN, and they get away with it, right? And so Democrats don't fight back hard enough.
God, it just drives me crazy. Okay, first of all, JusticeDemocrats.com. Okay, I guarantee you we had a couple of senators who were Justice Democrats that this situation would be a little different. By the way, why does the media get to call everything even? Because the Democrats don't fight back. And they don't say, hey, New York Times, it is your responsibility to say that the Republicans are being hypocrites in this case, because it is a fact. We can prove it, right? Do a giant press conference. Play the tapes. Just take what we just did in that earlier segment. Play it, right? But they won't do what they won't do. So I'm going to show you the two toughest things that the Democrats asked Gorsuch and how he deflected them so easily, right? Now, mind you, these are the toughest. The rest of it was... okay, long-winded questions that barely grazed them, but let me show you the best they have.
Here's a live example right now. We have this $10 million that is being spent on behalf of your confirmation. Do you think, for instance, that we on this panel ought to know who is behind that? And, well, answer that, and then I'll go on to a related question.
Senator, that's a policy question for this body.
Well, it's also a question of disclosure. You could ask right now that as a matter of courtesy, as a matter of respect to the process, that anybody who is funding this should declare themselves so that we can evaluate who is behind this effort.
Senator,
right? That wouldn't be a policy determination. That would be your values determination.
It would be a politics question. And I'm not, with all respect, Senator, going to get involved in politics.
Okay, I can't stand the smarminess of Gorsuch. And God, the mainstream media loves him. Mika Brzezinski and everyone else. They're like, oh, what a professional. He's so good. He's more right-wing than Antonin Scalia, which makes him a little left of Attila the Hun. But they're like, oh, he can speak in complete sentences. Yes! Yes, right? And now, so that was one of the toughest questions the Democrats asked. And it's a super fair question. Hey, there's secret groups, dark money groups, spending $10 million to make sure they put you on the Supreme Court. Can you just tell us who it is? He's like, that's a political question. No, it's not a political question. They're spending money. They're buying you a seat. Who are they? You're not going to answer who's buying you this seat? Well, can you not see? Can you at least not see? Because it is very relevant to the job you're about to have if you're on the Supreme Court. That gives the appearance of corruption. Because in Citizens United, they said that there was not even an appearance of corruption. When someone's paying $10 million to put you on the Supreme Court, are you telling me, Gorsuch, that doesn't give the appearance of corruption? That's a political question. No, it's not. It goes to the heart of how you will decide cases like Citizens United. If you're not going to answer that, then we have no information at all on what you're going to do in the Supreme Court. I vote no immediately. If you don't answer a single goddamn question, I vote no immediately. I call for a filibuster right now. Now, you'll never see a Democrat get worked up like that. I mean, Franken got a tiny bit frustrated. He called one of his opinions absurd, to say the least. And the media was like, Al Franken getting out of line. Oh my God,
we're going to have a conversation about the word absurd being out of line. I mean, in this era, in the Trump era, absurd is the weakest possible insult that you can tell anyone in government right now.
All right, and one final one. Here's the, again, these are, I'm not showing you the soft stuff. I'm showing you the hardest that the Democrats have, okay? This is the second toughest question.
If the Republicans had followed the Constitution and practiced, Chief Judge Merrick Garland would be on the Supreme Court today. I also respected you for calling Chief Judge Garland when your nomination was announced. I understand you respect him as a jurist, is that correct?
Very much so, Senator. Whenever I see his name attached to an opinion, it's one I read with special care. He's an outstanding judge.
Do you think he was treated fairly by this committee, yes or no?
Senator, as I explained to you before, I can't get involved in politics. And there's judicial canons that prevent me from doing that. And I think it would be very imprudent of judges to start commenting on political disputes between themselves or the various branches.
Days and days of him saying, it's a political question, I can't answer it. But Leahy, at least he brought up the right question, but he framed it all wrong. Was he treated unfairly? No, the question is, do you think that it is the constitutional responsibility of the Senate to confirm justices? That's a constitutional question. That's not a political question. Now, if you say, no, the Republicans were right, they have no constitutional duty to confirm justices, great, I don't confirm you. Get the hell out. Okay? You just told me that it's perfectly constitutional for me to never confirm any of the justices that a president puts up. If you think that it's unconstitutional, okay, then I have my answer. What the Republicans did last year was unconstitutional. Thank you very much. But he just keeps saying, that's a political question. And the Democrats go, oh, okay, let's go on to the next question. Okay, so look, I don't mind those two questions, but this is not how you effectively and strongly challenge a guy like Gorsuch. I mean, they never, like, because part of it is, and you got to understand, in Washington, they play patty cakes. So they're so polite to one another. Gorsuch is friends with a lot of these people. He went to the same schools. He goes to, and some of the Obama people were thrilled because they went to school with him that he was nominated. And it doesn't matter that he's to the right of Antonin Scalia and will shred some of our civil liberties. But I do declare he is such a well-spoken gentleman coming from the same circles as us. So you play patty cakes all day long. That you think these Democrats are going to stop these guys with Mitch McConnell saying, I'm bulldozing him in through April 8th?
They're not. I mean, have they really successfully stopped anyone? I mean, Betsy DeVos. Betsy DeVos is a nightmare. They barely even fought against Betsy DeVos. So, anyway.
JusticeDemocrats.com. Okay, let's go on to Cruz.
All right. Senator Ted Cruz has a massive hard-on for Neil Gorsuch, and if you don't believe me, take a quick look at this next video.
You began your career with the opportunity to serve as a law clerk to Byron White. Byron White is an extraordinary man. Byron White was the only justice that John F. Kennedy put on the Supreme Court. Byron White is, I believe, in fact, I'm quite certain, the only Supreme Court justice in history to lead the NFL in rushing, and also to graduate first in his class from Yale Law School. Could you share with this committee what it was like to be a law clerk for Byron White and to interact with him every day during your clerkship?
You know, as I said, he really was my childhood hero. And to actually get picked out of the pile, to spend a year with him, as Senator Lee's dad did, that's something we share in common too, was and remains the privilege of a lifetime. He'd sit down in my office, plunk himself down in a chair across the desk. We'd talk about a case and say, always started with a grunt. I mean, that's how he started a conversation. It's like, hello. So what does the great Justice Gorsuch think about this one? Okay. And then he'd go back and he'd think about it himself.
Later they would go on and make out.
What was that? Can you tell me how great it was to... Are these questions that are relevant to the American people or Neil Gorsuch's interpretation of the Constitution and how he plans on, you know, voting in certain cases that will affect everyone's life? I don't care about Byron White's history and how he was in the NFL or played in the... I don't know what the fuck he did with the NFL. I don't care, right? This is ridiculous. Like, this is the most ridiculous interaction I've seen in a hearing probably ever.
So, look, they're doing a couple things. One, they're running out the clock. So they're just wasting time so that he can just get confirmed. Second thing is they're trying to put a positive spin on Gorsuch. So they ask him these softball questions, which allows him to give folksy answers. This is all pre-planned. So then he gives a story about how, and then he would grunt before his answer.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's so folksy.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh. Right? Oh, so folks. Okay. And then the third thing is, Cruz gets to use this as a way to brag to his conservative voters. Look at me having a man crush on Gorsuch. I told you we'd get one somebody who's the right wing, some more right wing than Scalia. And so, and he can't help himself. And that's where our legendary producer, Jared Jackson, zooms in on his face. Okay. And he's like, and the way that they smugly smile at one another is infuriating. But you look, tip of the iceberg. They did this for literally ad nauseum, okay?
Yeah.
But we're going to give you just one more clip because I can't subject you more and to anything more than that. But he wasn't done with Brian White yet. Watch this.
Now, you and I both had the experience of clerking at the Supreme Court after Justice White had ended his time on the basketball court.
Yeah.
And then, or maybe you were luckier than I. For those who do not know, above the Supreme Court, above the roof of the courtroom is a basketball court, which is referred to tongue-in-cheek as the highest court in the land. And Justice White, for many years, would play in the basketball games. NFL Hall of Fame football player with a bunch of pencil-neck law clerks.
Yep.
And his elbows and fouls were legendary. When I was clerking, he was no longer playing. Perhaps, were you lucky enough to get him up on the basketball court?
He would come up for a game of horse with the clerks, former law clerks at reunions.
How's his jump shot?
His best shot at that age was from the free throw line back up over his head like that. And he could hit it pretty regularly. His eye-hand coordination was just uncanny. And he'd ask me, how many of these guys you honestly recognize? And I was one of those pencil-neck law clerks. And the truth was, I thought I knew a lot about the Supreme Court.
Oh, Byron White's jump shot. I see we've gotten to something relevant.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Okay. And, you know, he said it, Gorsuch did, with such drama. Like,
yeah.
You know, a game of horse.
No, the whole thing, I mean, the way Ted Cruz asked the question is full of drama, right? Like, could you tell me, were you lucky enough to... Oh, as soon as he started that question, I rolled my eyes, like, were you lucky enough to see him play basketball?
These are the serious jurists that the Republicans claim that they are, and they care so much about the Constitution that they don't ask him any questions about the Constitution. All they do is ask him about Byron White's jump shot. And finally, let me add one point of serious analysis here. One of the things that Cruz did ask about was originalism. So this is the doctrine that conservatives believe in, that you should take the Founding Fathers' words with their original intent, mm-hmm, and not have the Constitution be a living, breathing document that we affect in these generations. So let me quote...
Sounds like a smart idea. It's not like society evolves in any way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, Anna, here's someone who agrees with you. Thomas Jefferson. So here's what Jefferson said. No society can make a perpetual Constitution or even a perpetual law. The earth belongs always to the living generation. So, if you were trying to find the original intent of the Founding Fathers, the guy who wrote the Declaration of Independence and had a huge hand in helping James Madison write the Constitution, said that it should be a living document. It should not be just the original intent. In fact, I'm going to give you one more quote from Jefferson. Some men look at constitutions with sanctimonious reverence. Oh, what a great way to describe Cruz and Gorsuch today. And deem them like the Ark of the Covenant, too sacred to be touched, who ascribe to the men of preceding age a wisdom more than human, and suppose what they did to be beyond amendment. Let us follow no such examples, nor weakly believe that one generation is not as capable as another of taking care of itself and of ordering its own affairs. So if you actually cared about the original intent of the Founding Fathers, you would have none of the judicial beliefs of Gorsuch or Cruz, let alone their beliefs about Byron White's basketball game. I do have to confess, it's kind of cool that there is a basketball court above the Supreme Court, which I didn't know.
The highest court.
It's the highest court of the land. All right, we got to take a break here, guys. We'll be right back. actually listen to other human beings.
Wow.
Including his law clerks. That's the whole point of a law clerk. That's like Anna saying, oh, Cenk, in the production meetings, he would say, what do you think, Anna? Oh, what a great man. What a great man. What the fuck else are you supposed to say?
Yeah.
Why are you even having the meeting if you don't care what they say? Anyway, all right, Mitch Fallon says, Mitch McConnell is this disgrace that Mitch is everywhere. Gabby Marita says, Democrats are more concerned with not insulting the people who go to their cocktail parties than they are with representing voters. Unfortunately, very true. Heiserberg says, is this a confirmation hearing or an audition for Pivot Man in the great Republican circle jerk?
I was going to say circle jerk when we were covering the story. I'm trying to clean up my language, so I'm abstaining from that type of talk. But, yeah, that was a huge circle jerk. Like, anyway.
Yeah.
I feel like we needed to see Cruz's hands on the table. Because we couldn't, and it was strange.
So. Okay, so I have to say that I don't think I'm versed well enough in the circle jerk phenomenon. Can there be a two-person circle jerk, or is that just...
Making
hand love to one another. Don't you need a third person for a circle? And then furthermore, what's the pivot man in a circle jerk? I just don't know enough about this.
Oh, I don't know what the pivot man is either.
Yeah, I mean, so Heiserberg, maybe you can educate us. But I'm now amused by the idea of Ted Cruz asking those questions.
So when Byron White was circle jerking you, what was his favorite shot? Was it the money shot? He would actually do it like this.
Oh, right my above his head.
Anyway, finally, Dan's Mon Arbre says, it is obnoxious that we pay politicians more than minimum wage.
And it's, give them health care.
I know. Just looking at those guys. And the reason, by the way, they got to get them approved by April 8th is because they're going to go on a giant recess. Why are they not in recess?
No, they've been working very hard.
Oh,
okay,
geez.
Very hard.
All right, donors to the journalism campaign, $27 from Lars in California, $100 from John in Georgia, $127 from Rebecca in Arizona. Much love. What's next?
All right. Oftentimes when you hear accusations of voter fraud, it's Republicans accusing Democrats of engaging in that type of behavior. Well, it turns out that we now have Steve Curtis, former chairman of the Colorado Republican Party, accused of engaging in voter fraud himself. In fact, his ex-wife had moved to a different state and wanted to register to vote in that state and realized that she wasn't able to do so because she was registered in Colorado. And then, after an investigation took place, she was able to find that her ex-husband, Steve Curtis, had voted in her name, registered her to vote in Colorado, and voted under her name, okay, for Donald Trump. So I think it's super interesting, especially when you consider the fact that this individual gave an interview accusing Democrats of voter fraud. Take a look.
Want to be called a name, no matter how false it is, and then the Democrats just do what they want. And it seems to me, and correct me if I'm wrong, that virtually every case of voter fraud I can remember in my lifetime was committed by Democrats. Am I onto something here, or do I just not have facts?
Absolutely. A few years ago, there was, and they commit voter fraud against one another as well.
So, virtually every case of voter fraud in his lifetime committed by Democrats, oops, except for him, which, by the way, is not true, except for a lot of Republicans. Funny enough, almost every case of voter fraud that we've covered on the show has been more systematic done by Republican officials. Right. Now, there was one giant case back in 2012, but the Democrats, and I remember Nancy Pelosi speaking about this, they said they didn't want to make a big deal out of it because it would only help the Republicans because claim that voter fraud's a real issue.
Mm-hmm.
So they actually let the Republicans get away with voter fraud without much publicity at all these days. And they're the ones that keep doing it. And this guy got caught with his hand in the cookie jar. His ex-wife said was, quote, livid that he did this. She had no participation in it at all. And she found it demeaning and presumptuous.
Right, exactly. So, again, he's the one engaging in voter fraud, and he has been charged as a result with forgery and voter fraud. And look, voter fraud, to me, has become a case of whoever smelt it, dealt it, right? The people that make the biggest deal about voter fraud are the individuals who are engaging in voter fraud or have been tempted to engage in voter fraud, right? Like, because regular individuals don't think about it, and they don't obsess about it. Republicans obsess about it either because they're projecting or because they want to do away with certain voting rights that would benefit Democrats, right? Make it harder for the elderly or students to vote with these voter ID laws. Okay. That's what it's really about. It's about getting enough support to elect individuals that they want for their party, not Democrats.
And minorities, of course.
And so, minorities.
And the bottom line is it goes to the same goal, which is, by hook or by crook, I'm going to get Republicans elected. If I have to say that you're going to have less voting booths in minority areas or college campuses, and so restrict people's voters' rights, if it says voter ID laws, so 25% of African Americans in the country who don't have driver licenses because they live in urban areas or they can't afford a car, etc., I'm going to do it so that Republicans win. I don't care if it restricts voting rights. And if it means I have to do voter fraud myself to get Republicans to win, well, then that's what I'll do. Because the Republicans are by hook or by crook.
What I don't understand is, was it worth it? I mean, was it really worth it? Because it's one vote, and you're now facing serious charges because you engaged in this criminal activity just to cast one more ballot in Trump's favor. Was it worth it?
Because he can't help himself. That's the way that he thinks. I don't care by any means necessary. So speaking of by hook or by crook, they caught him on camera.
Did you vote for your ex-wife in the last election? Do you offer an apology? Does this affect your credibility with the radio listeners?
Oh,
to say the least.
He don't like that. We're not going to talk about that. By the way, he was like way in his personal space.
Yeah.
And Rob Lowe's personal space.
I love that reporting. And I loved his, I'm so guilty, we're not going to talk about this. And it's not a random dude. It's not a low-level official. That is the former chairman of the Republicans in Colorado. The chairman of the Republican Party in that state. Stone cold busted.
All right, one more story for you in the first hour, which is, of course, longer than an hour, but still, we're having fun, especially because I'm on it. all right. There is a growing number of former Trump supporters coming forward and explaining that they are experiencing a serious case of buyer's remorse. Case in point, Craig Moss, who was recently interviewed by CNN. Take a look. Craig Moss was a true believer in Donald Trump.
100% Trump supporter, there is no other choice.
During the presidential campaign, he followed Trump to 45 rallies across the U.S. And he did it for a very personal reason.
I came home and found my son Rob J.R. Moss dead in his bed, and it was devastating to me.
We will help all of those people so seriously addicted. We'll get them assistance.
Moss believed Trump's campaign promises, especially when Trump reached out to him at a rally.
And I know what you went through, and he's a great father. I can see it. And your son is proud of you. Your son is proud of you.
Tell me about this guitar. Do you play this guitar anymore?
Nope.
Why not?
Not on the Trump trail anymore, and I've lost my heart to play the Trump songs.
Moss, who believes his son might still be alive if he'd had health insurance, can't believe Trump supports the Republican health care plan. It would increase the number of uninsured Americans, and it would end the Obamacare requirement that the 31 states with expanded Medicaid cover addiction services.
I believed everything he said.
And now?
And now I don't believe that he was true in his word when he was speaking. I think he was looking for vote, to be honest with you. It's not at all what Mr. Trump promised everybody he was going to provide for us. And I feel that now. I feel hurt inside.
Now that Moss has changed his tune, the only song he wanted to sing for us is a song he wrote in memory of his son.
Thinking about the time we spent together.
So I often criticize CNN, but that was a great report. I'm really glad they did that, and we'll have the link below for so you guys can watch it. I actually feel terrible for this guy.
Of course.
And no, I say that because during the campaign and after the campaign, we often made fun of Trump voters. And we criticized them. And I think we've been proven right. But we would also add, guys, remember, we're actually trying to look out for them. I know they don't believe it. I know they think that we're trying to trick them or we're no good libs or whatever they think it is. But we knew what he was going to do because we study this stuff. We knew he wasn't going to look out for you guys. We knew he was going to look out for his donors. We knew he was going to rebuild the swamp. We knew he was going to devastate healthcare. What did you think was going to happen when they took away Obamacare? Did you think they were going to cover more people? The Republicans? So that's what infuriates me, and that's why sometimes I do criticize outlets like CNN, because people who watch television are left confused. They're not sure. But if you know politics at all, there was a 0% chance that the Republicans would expand healthcare. You knew, anyone who knows politics knew that they would reduce healthcare. They would reduce the number of people who were covered. But guys like that honestly thought Trump would take care of them and the Republicans would expand healthcare. So yes, that's partly his fault, but it's also partly the media's fault for not making it clear enough. And by the way, for being obsessed about the personal stuff and the Russian stuff.
Yes.
And not focusing on the policies that actually hurt guys like this.
So, I have a lot to say about this. First of all, to your first point about us criticizing Trump supporters and, you know, where that came from, I want to be clear about something. So, the things that I'm most fired up about and passionate about actually don't directly impact me in any way. I'm done with college. I have my master's degree. I have no student loan debt, okay? None of those issues are going to affect me, okay? I have a great job. I'm living a great life. But the reason why I got fired up about those issues and the reason why I was upset on election night isn't because I'm upset about how my life is going to turn out. It's because I believe in true patriotism, which is looking out for the American people, creating opportunities that you got to take advantage of that are being destroyed by politicians, mainly the Republican Party. That's the reason why I got fired up, right? So yes, was I highly critical? Did I say some very hurtful things about Trump supporters? I absolutely did, and I think you're right. Time is proving us right over and over again, and it will continue to do so, right? And it's clear in Trump's economic proposals. It's clear in what he wants to do with healthcare. He is not looking out for you. He claimed to be anti-establishment when in reality he was the exact type of person who exploited a corrupt political system for his own personal gain. He is not going to look out for you, and I think that's clear. The other thing, real quick, that I wanted to add to all of this is, yes, the media is at fault because they do very superficial, surface-level coverage of important issues. And it's not just the media that's at fault, okay? We as Americans deserve more and need to demand more from our politicians. What did Trump do on the campaign trail? All he did was exploit your rage. All he did was exploit your emotions. But he never gave you any concrete policy ideas. He never detailed any proposals. All he did was get up there, talk off the cuff, right, and embroider a ridiculously simplistic logo or a motto, I should say, on his stupid hat. That's all he did. You should have demanded more. We never talk about policy during elections anymore. All we talk about is the horse race. What did Nate Silver say? What did Nate Silver say? Who gives a fuck what Nate Silver says? What are their policies? Donald Trump didn't have any policy ideas or detailed policy ideas. Hillary Clinton did, but instead of actually talking about that, all she did was attack Trump for constantly talking shit. So that's what happened during this election. We as Americans deserve more, and we need to demand more. No more identity politics. More. We need more demands on what these politicians are going to do and how they're going to do it.
So, a lot of you watching get your news from online media, not just us, but you've already read the news in so many different outlets, and you can actually look up their policy positions. But you have to remember, most people in this country still don't live in your world. They're older, and older people get their news from television, and television almost never talks about policy. So in this case, the part of the program that Trump and the Republicans are cutting is they would drop an addiction treatment and mental health mandate that covers 1.3 million Americans. But did the television guys tell you about the different ideas that the Republicans had for healthcare?
No.
Never!
Of course not!
Never! So this poor guy, he said,
quote, I believed everything he said. Because what would Trump do? He was, ironically, the most typical politician. I'm going to give everybody everything they want. You got a Christmas list? I'm going to give it to you all. I'm going to cover more people in healthcare, and their premiums are going to be lower. How? And give credit to at least Scott Pelley of CBS, who kept asking him, how? He said, I'm going to do it. It's going to be fantastic. It's going to be tremendous. Yes, you should have had a little bit more. You should have been a little bit more incredulous about that as a voter. But then they never told you. The Republicans have never proposed expanding health care, nor are they ever likely to. If you vote for a Republican, they will cut your health care. They will cut your health care. And now look at what happened. They're proposing to cut it for about 25 million people. And this guy thinks if my son had health care, and he didn't, he was 24. And what's the Republican plan now? Hey, if you're young, you don't have to go on health care anymore. There's no more mandates. Don't worry about it. Take a chance. We'll lower premiums anyway. And then, oops, he didn't have health care. And in this case, he died. Right? But they never told that guy that that's what was going to happen under Republican proposals. So
I feel bad for him. And I think that there's an interesting conversation taking place right now as to whether or not individuals should feel bad for Trump supporters who are now feeling buyer's remorse. But, you know, at the same time, we got to take responsibility for our actions. Donald Trump is a reflection of this country. And it's a reflection of a lack of critical thinking. It's a reflection of this obsession of nonsense, non-issues, polls, drama, the horse race, whatever it is. We need to demand more, and our media needs to do a better job in actually covering the issues that matter. Forget ratings for like half a second, just for 1 year as the election takes place, so people know what they're voting for. Hold these politicians' feet to the fire. That's all I'm asking.
But it's become one big reality show, so we shouldn't be surprised that a reality show host won the election. Yeah. Now, one last thing. People are wondering if Trump's numbers, in a different article today I read, they're dropping, and I talked about this earlier in the week, are they dropping because of the travel ban and the Russian talk? No, that stuff's been happening for weeks and weeks and weeks. Mm-hmm. No, the poll numbers are finally dropping because guys like this are going, oh, he didn't mean it. Of course he's not going to help us. He's going to help his big donor friends. That's why I'm telling you, Trump and the Republicans have no idea how badly they're going to get mauled. Because, yes, you could fool some of the people some of the time, but you can't fool all the people all the time. And at some point, the rubber hits the road, and that rubber hits the road when you lose your Meals on Wheels and you lose your health care. And someone you know dies. Now, of course, in his case, his son died a while back before Trump got elected. But now you see the program that's getting cut that you thought was going to get added to.
Right.
And so that is what's happening today is people go, oh, it turns out he's not going to drain the swamp. He is the swamp. Okay. We got to take another quick break. When we come back... You know, there's a couple of things going on. One is yet another case of a Republican politician who has no empathy at all.
Oh, I'm gonna drag him in that story. Not physically, like
he's gonna get dragged. Though. He's gonna get dragged.
Dragging.
And the LA Sheriff's Office goes after Wyclef Jean. But is it that clear? Is it that clear? I might have a surprising opinion on that.
He's only gonna be gone till November, so don't worry. That was him, right? That was a Wyclef Jean song? Okay. Anyway, we have that story and more when we come back. And he won't be gone till November. He's still around.
What?
We talk about TYT Army being so strong. Usually they help us run our show. Now they're going to help us run the country.
Oh, yeah.
Like this.
It's time that we reclaim democracy for the people.
We had a huge victory for Wolfpack.
When Lincoln said this is a country by, of, and for, he said of the people, not of corporations.
Our representatives don't represent us. Whoa! Democracy!
United!
We are!
We are!
Too strong!
We've got this thousand.
thousands of volunteers, and you can be among them.
With Wolfpack, the mission is so clear.
Money is killing our democracy.
96% of Americans want it.
When you get the power back, oh, that feels good. This is just the beginning. Go get them, man. Up and at them. Knock, knock.
We're coming for them!
Wolf-pack.com.
This is the Gas Lamp Killer, Peace to Absent Presents 2016 shit.
I like drums. I like big drums. Heavy, funky, deep drums. I'm not classically trained. I just started out as a record collector. I have synthesizers. I have all these modular synths and fun DJ tools that I use to make psychedelic sounds. It's not just the music. People want to leave their bodies in order to connect with the spirit world. And when you're making music, it's a similar kind of thing. You want to escape your day-to-day to leaving this shit behind and finding more of a deeper place to create from. That is the essence of Gas Lamp Killer music.
Why? Even it's worse than two.
It's so encouraging to see these brave ex-Trumpies fessing up and coming forward. Gives us all hope.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm telling you, they're going to get routed in 2018. especially if they're running against populist Democrats rather than corporate Democrats, mm-hmm. their only chance is that the corporate Democrats run against them. JusticeDemocrats.com. John Connor says, recess equals time to call their donors for re-election money. Totally correct. John, that's such a great point. They take these giant long recesses in Congress so they go beg for cash from rich people and corporations. All right.
Cash for Congress.
Well, that's right. That's a good point. It's a great point. If you were tweeting that in, I would give you a t-shirt.
Thank you.
Okay.
Except I have like 50,000 of them.
Okay, yeah. That's true.
Yeah.
Because we wear them all the time.
Yeah.
By the way, I think there's a super chat thing on YouTube. I want to read comments from that more often, too, along with hashtag TYT Live. So if you're watching on YouTube.com/TYT, I'll try to read some of those super chat comments, too. Okay, and Yvette, $500 for the journalism drive. Thank you, Yvette. So let me see where we are now, TYTnetwork.com/go. 1503. Come on. Today somebody was saying, hey, you guys should stop before you get to 2 million. Wrong again, Bob.
Who said that?
I can't help them. Okay. But let's get to 2, and in which case we'll hire 2 more people. And so far, so good. I think you guys have been pretty happy with the guys we've hired and the work that they've done. All right. What's next?
Yes. All right. Grammy Award-winning hip-hop artist Wyclef Jean was mistakenly detained as a robbery suspect in Los Angeles. He was handcuffed for about 6 minutes and was livid as a result, but his car did match the description of the suspect's car, which is why authorities detained him. Now, of course, they made a huge mistake, and so the Sheriff's Department in Los Angeles has released an apology statement, and they essentially say that they've apologized for any inconvenience this process caused to Mr. Jean. And also, it is unfortunate that Mr. Jean was detained for 6 minutes during this investigation, as he had no involvement whatsoever in this violent crime. Now, Wyclef did tweet and also Instagram post about the situation. Here is a video from his Instagram page showing what happened. And in this video, you can hear him threatening to sue the cops. So take a look.
You can give them the address in the studio. But this is, just so y'all know, I am going to sue the LA police. I am going to sue the police. So probably that you put the cuffs on me.
So believe it or not, I'm a little split on this story, okay? So, by the way, I like how the cops put in there. He was detained for 6 minutes, only 6 minutes!
Yeah.
Okay, so why am I split on it?
Wait,
you want to jump in?
Before you explain why you're split on it, I don't even know if I told you guys what why cops were looking for a suspect. There was apparently a violent robbery, and so it happened in West Hollywood. And look, I have to say, police officers in West Hollywood are actually pretty awesome. And that's not just me saying it as, like, a white girl living in West Hollywood. I just know from experience and the way that they react to members of the community that they're pretty great. So I don't think that there was any foul play here. It's just that his car matched the description of the suspect's car.
So, but that's what the cops say. And I'm a tiny bit surprised by that because Wyclef must be driving a pretty nice car. And in this case, the suspect allegedly attacked and held up this man and woman at gunpoint and then jumped back in his car and drove away. Are robbery suspects now driving Bentleys? I don't know what Wyclef's car is, but like, it's just weird. And so what they don't say is the suspect was black and Wyclef kind of looked like him. But that's kind of implicit in that statement. So without the context of the gross discrimination that African Americans have been facing in this country and how they systematically get pulled over wrongly all the time, I would say this story is not that big a deal, okay? But there is that context, so I'm not saying it's not a big deal because context is important.
So here's what happened, though. Cops had handcuffed him and detained him for about 6 minutes, as they say, and they didn't let him go until other cops showed up and they kind of, like, cleared him of any wrongdoing. And so I'm wondering what happened. Like, did other cops show up and they're like, hey, that's Wyclef Jean. like, and he's tweeting about this, so, like, let's let him go. Because I feel like if he didn't have a public following, then the situation might have ended up differently.
Yeah, and so, look, let me quote Reuters here, go to graphic 7. The statement says Jean was placed in handcuffs because he displayed, quote, furtive movements and demeanor, such as walking towards the trunk of the car, despite deputies asking him not to. So that, let me just then bifurcate this. So on the one hand, it is entirely possible that he did match the description, not just because he was black, but he kind of actually did look like the guy. The car did look like the car, and then he didn't listen to all the orders, so they're like, wait, I got to just pause here for a second, and since you're not listening to orders, I got to handcuff you for a brief period of time, and then other guys come in and go, no, that's not him, mm-hmm. and then we unhandcuff you, and we're done with it, and it's not that big a deal, right? Wyclef says, I was treated like a criminal until other police showed up and pointed out they had the wrong person. Yeah, because they thought you were, right? Mm-hmm. Now, it might be that they thought he was because he's black and he was in the neighborhood. And again, the context matters. Or it might be because he looked like the guy. And so there's a tinge here of the celebrity saying, like, how dare you do it to me? And so, and maybe I'm totally misreading that and being super unfair to Wyclef, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, I feel like this stuff happens to people all the time.
And it does happen to people all the time, and it sucks. And look, honestly, in situations like this, I don't know what cops are supposed to do. If the person does seem to match the description of the suspect, whether it's their car or their physical appearance, whatever it is, right? So do the cops just say, well, we don't know for sure, so we're just going to let him go? No, they have to stop him, right? So, like, I get that, but also, I did think about what it must feel like to be a celebrity and not be recognized by people. You know what I mean?
So what?
I know, but, like, I wonder if that got under his skin as well, right?
It might be. You know, Ali G used to do this skit, and he would, like, he'd get Newt Gingrich, and then he'd get him to spell his name, and he'd keep misspelling it. And it would get under his skin so much because that's his ego, right?
Yeah.
And he's like, how could you not know who I am, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a brilliant way that he undermined that or showed the highlight of it. So in this case, if cops come to me and they say, okay, well, look, we're going to detain you for a second because you match a suspect, I'd be like, I think if they were reasonable, if, that's a giant if, I think, oh, okay, go ahead, run it, because I'm not the suspect. It's not that big a deal, and you'll sort it out, and we'll figure it out. Now, they detain you for 6 hours or 6 days,
yeah,
and there's some sort of injustice.
That's when you say, someone please call 911.
Then it's horrible. But if they detain me for 6 minutes while they figured out if I was a robbery suspect or not, I don't think that's the end of the world. Now, on the other hand, Wyclef says, I'm sure no father wants his sons or daughters to see him in handcuffs, especially if he's innocent. If his kids are in the car and they see that happening, and then he has a sense, as Johnny Cochran used to say, it doesn't matter how successful you are as an African-American. They're still going to handcuff you in front of your kids. Well, that's super frustrating, and I can understand his frustration about that. But the devil's in the details here. The question is, did the cops in that brief period of time act reasonably or not? And it is super hard for us to know.
Yeah.
And I just think that's the reality.
Fair enough.
Okay.
All right. Now to a story that enrages me. Members of Congress are trying to find ways to improve certain programs that help disadvantaged students afford college. Now, in that equation is Pell Grants. Pell Grants, of course, are grants given to individuals who do not have enough of an income to pay for college. Now, during this discussion, Representative Glenn Grothman from Wisconsin tried to make an argument about how maybe Pell Grants don't make a lot of sense and maybe they should be cut. Maybe they should be reformed to the point where they're not as available to disadvantaged students. And then he gave one reason that I thought was extremely strange. Take a look.
I've received anecdotal evidence in my district of people not getting married. Because, of course, if you don't get married, it's easier to be in poverty and get Pell Grants. Would you care to comment on that? Anybody comment on that? I've heard it from several people. You're the experts.
Yeah, so everyone was very confused as to why he was asking a ridiculous question. He himself admitted in the framing of that question that he had anecdotal evidence that people were abstaining from marriage just so they would qualify for Pell Grants. First of all, he's an idiot. People who are applying for Pell Grants are college students, right? They're people fresh out of high school in a lot of cases who are like 18 years old, maybe. And secondly, why are Republicans, specifically conservative Republicans, so obsessed with the idea of marriage being a sound economic policy? Like, oh, you can't afford college? Just get married. Mush off someone else. Be financially dependent. That's our economic policy for you. No, that's not a good way to tell people how to afford college. Okay, encouraging them to get married is not economic policy. How about you come up with something that actually makes sense and actually helps the American people rather than trying to find ways to cut certain programs that help disadvantaged individuals, afford a higher education. What an idiot. What an idiot.
So I didn't think you were going to go in that direction.
You're a fucking idiot.
Okay, I want to attack him on a different thing. So, but first, one of the people he asked was Barmak Nasirian. He's the Director of Federal Relations and Policy Analysis at the American Association of State Colleges and Universities. And when presented with this absurd anecdotal evidence about people not getting married at the age of 17 and 18 so they can get qualify for Pell Grants, he said, "I'm not sure what to do with that information."
Yeah, it's ridiculous. It's ridiculous.
Okay, so, but to me, that was not the straw that broke the camel's back.
No, that was the most absurd thing he said, but get a load of, more of his accusations against individuals who need these Pell Grants.
The Pell Grant program or other programs have been subject to criticism for even when I was in college by the middle class. People get tired of the American government hating the middle class, and they have to kick in for their kids' programs or their kids have to take out loans. Well, maybe kids from some other families seem to get things for free. Do you think one way to deal with this problem would be to have, say, no Pell Grants in your freshman year, at least have for the freshman year, have the kids who aren't in the middle class take out loans like the kids in the middle class already have to, and that way you could make sure that everybody who's going to college after at least they get through the first year are more serious about college? You think that'd be a fair thing to do?
Carson, I think what you're asking is if there's a Robin Hood effect in higher education where middle class and upper middle class people are paying for poor people and who aren't ready for college. Am I understanding your question?
Which is the unfairness, the resentment. I know in many ways in this country we hate the middle class. You know, we love the rich, we love the poor, yep. We hate the middle class.
So people
wonder why. Sometimes they use these Pell Grants too for goodies and electronics, and they resent the fact that by doing it right, their kids are penalized.
You know who hates the middle class? Grossman does. He hates the middle class. How do you think people from low socioeconomic statuses make it to the middle class? They do it through education, right? And you want to do away with what little government money they get in order to afford college. And then he has the fucking audacity to talk about, oh, why don't these students take out loans like the middle class? Oh, you think the couple thousand dollars that they get through Pell Grants pays for their college education? Here's what's really going on. Everyone's taking out loans for college right now. That's how expensive it is. Everyone, middle class, disadvantaged, even people who come from wealthier families have to take out loans because tuition is so insanely expensive, which is why right now we have $1.2 trillion in student loan debt. Okay? That's what's going on. You hate the middle class. Okay? You hate the middle class.
So, he's basically saying, why don't you take out loans from my banker friends, which then, thanks to the laws we passed, that will be an albatross around your neck for the rest of your life, and you'll never be able to get rid of. And so instead, some poor people actually can live the American dream by also getting an education? Yuck. Ugh. I mean, how dare they try to get up to our level or just get up to the middle class? And then to me, the most obnoxious part of it was so they could get goodies and electronics. Look at how loaded that statement is. And look at how much they hate the poor. They hate them. Their assumptions are,
oh, they're all a bunch of rip-off artists. They're not actually trying to get an education. They're just getting the Pell Grant so they can get electronics and goodies.
Yeah.
And they're dropping out of college right away. No, in fact, experts explain that the moment that you need the grants the most is actually your first year.
That's exactly right.
And so that you could actually, that if you can get past the first year, you're far more likely to stay in school, etc. What kind of sense does it make if you can't even attend the first year of school because you don't have any grants? Well, how the hell are you going to get to the third year if you didn't have the money to get into the first year?
Yeah.
Because he doesn't want you to get an education.
Also, can we just finally accept the fact that having electronics like a computer or a telephone is not just a luxury, okay? It's something that you literally need in today's society just to keep up with things. If you're in college, you need a computer, okay? You might not have a computer and you might rely on your cell phone as your computer. A lot of people do that because the smartphone, you can surf the web, you can do your research. I've done that when I'm traveling and I don't want to, you know, lug my computer around everywhere with me. So, like, this notion that electronics are only reserved for the wealthiest, right? And if you're poor, you need to live like the piece of shit that they think that you are. It drives me absolutely insane. By the way, this is the same representative who in 2012 wanted to pass legislation that wanted to classify single parenthood as child neglect or child abuse. That's the kind of politician that person is, okay, from Wisconsin.
Very likely literally needed for your coursework. But a lot of these old Republicans grew up in a town where they're like, oh, well, I used to write things out. What do you need a computer for? Are you just trying to play video games? No, idiot. That's what I need to do my coursework on. Because we live in the modern world. And you can't qualify for a Pell Grant unless you can't afford it. Unless you can't afford college.
Right.
So this is the only way you can go to college. But again, he doesn't want you to go to college. He has nothing but disdain for the poor. He doesn't want you to make it in the middle class. He doesn't believe in the American dream. He thinks it's reserved for his friends. And if your kids don't make it, ha-ha, got you.
Later on, he mentioned that he believed there were too many people going to college. Okay, he stated that himself. There are too many people going to college, and then he advocated for schools where people can go and learn how to be welders and things like that. Okay, you know where his mind is, okay? If he thinks that you are from a lower socioeconomic status, there should not be an economic ladder that you can climb in order to be part of the middle class. He hates the middle class. He hates the poor. The only people he cares about is the wealthy or those who share his ridiculous conservative beliefs. Okay.
In other words, he's saying you should be our errand boys. You should be welders. You should just work for us. Okay, how dare you try to make your life a little bit better, your kids' lives a little bit better. And ironically, these are the same Republicans who turn around and go, what? You have all the opportunity in the world in America. And if you didn't make it, it's your fault because we gave you all the opportunity. While in the middle of the night, he tries to rob you of that opportunity. This is why we get frustrated at the mainstream media. Because you think they cover that? You think that that's on television? CNN for... we talked about this in a post game for 90 minutes straight the other day. And you turn it on at any time. One issue alone. But usually it's Russia. But whatever it is,
yes.
Some sort of tweet or investigation, they never get into the details. So people don't know that the Republicans want to rob them of education. They just don't know it. But they do. Okay. We got to take a quick break here. When we come back... for the first time, perhaps a number of studies showing that if you're physically attractive, it could hurt you. Interesting. We'll do that when we return. I got a bunch of things to go through. The only Republican would have ever voted for Bernie, you would have done worse than Hillary Clinton.
They're so miserable. All right, I'm going to stop myself. So I say things that are offensive.
If I ran for office, and that would be a trippy day, right? I'd break even more rules than Trump. If I had all the money in the world, I would enjoy that. We have a great show for you. Steve's answer is C. Dave's is A, and the correct answer is, of course, B. Guys are the worst. Here's the story, and it's not funny.
It seems just comically unfair and ridiculous. The Democratic Party just sucks right now. It just sucks because no one cares for it. We should probably be right.
Mohammed Abdenur says about Wyclef, he should sue them for as much as possible. Not every wrongful arrestees have the ability to scare them to deter profiling. Really interesting and good point, Mohammed.
Yeah.
And Mary says, if it wasn't for the Pell Grant, I'd be close to $90,000 in debt for a bachelor's. But Mary, that's exactly why that Republican congressman wanted you to not be able to get Pell Grants.
Yep.
So that you could be $90,000 in debt to his banker friends. Just a couple more thank yous here. To $15 from Paula in Germany. Thank you, Paula. $50 from Cynthia in Nevada. and 127 for Melissa in Illinois. You guys are the best. And that's tytnetwork.com/go to fund the campaign. That's almost over, about 37, 38 days left. And then member shout outs of the day are Byron Davis. Reminds me of Brian White. Oh, his jump shot.
Did you ever have the pleasure of watching him play basketball?
I actually did, and I did see. I once saw him make a money shot, and it was amazing. Anyway, and Joshua Emmanuel, thank you guys. Some great post games today. We've got another one. Usually, new personal fun stories. We also have TYT Classics tonight. That is where we look at older clips.
Mm-hmm.
Which, by the way, if you're a member, the archives go back all the way to 2012.
Whoa.
If I was a member, if I kind of am a member, if I had more time, let's put it that way, it'd be super cool to randomly listen to some old shows. Me and Tim Collins did it for like a minute today,
mm-hmm.
and we were talking about what Obama was doing wrong. That was so right. I loved it.
You were always spot on when it came to politics, but there's some social commentary videos from years ago where, like, Irina found a few today, and she's like, oh, my God.
I know. I was a bad man in the past.
Yeah.
I was a bad man.
Yeah.
So you'll see that, members, today. TYTnetwork.com/join to become a member. And then tonight for old school, that's later on at around 11 o'clock Eastern, me, Jesus, Wes Clark, and Michael Shore. It ought to be a great old school. You're going to be on old school again next week.
Yeah.
And we're even going to let Johnny Pye on for once.
Okay, so I miss John. John's away right now.
I know.
I was away like for a week. And so now I'm just like, oh, it's not the same. I need someone to be in our production meetings who like poo-poos on every suggestion I make for masters.
Johnny Pye, we miss you. All right, what's next?
All right. Physical attractiveness usually leads to positive things for individuals who are hot. But there is one massive downside based on a massive study that was done by various universities, which include Harvard, the University of Laverne, and Santa Clara University. They wanted to see how being physically attractive impacts relationships, whether it be, regular, love interest relationships or marriages. And what they found was that there's actually a huge downside to being hot. So they found that through various experiments that you have a greater likelihood of relationship disillusion, briefer relationships, and also decreased effort in relationship maintenance. Okay, so they did about four different experiments or studies to kind of come up with these conclusions, and here's what they found. So in the first study of 238 individuals, researchers found that those rated as more attractive in high school yearbooks were married for shorter durations and more likely to divorce.
I'm not sure I would have been in that category, so I feel a little good about this news. Oh, yeah, at least my marriage is going to last longer.
Okay.
Take that.
So then they looked at the IMDb profiles of various celebrities and then had people rate the attractiveness of these celebrities and then looked into their relationship history. Here's what the researchers found. More attractive celebs were less likely to stay married and experience briefer marriages. Okay. So let's look at the final experiment, which I thought was interesting. In study four, good looks hurt relationships because they predicted increased interest in attractive alternatives among those who were dissatisfied with their relationship.
Ding, okay. Ding, ding. Yeah, you've got a winner.
I'm surprised Harvard did the study, but whatever. I think it's the most obvious thing in the world. I think cheating relies almost solely on what your opportunities are, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can be the strongest person ever, like strong-willed, like, I love my significant other, but there's going to be like a lull in your relationship at some point. And if some hottie is trying to like rub up against you, like, what are you going to do? You're going to say no? Like, you should, but a lot of people don't.
Yeah, so it's the oldest adage there is. It's just, how likely are you to cheat? Depends on how much opportunity you have, right? And it depends on, as I was saying, honestly, how strong the other person is coming at you. It also might slightly depend on if you're a guy or a girl, right? So why do you think celebrities get divorced more often, which they do? It's because they have all the opportunity in the world. If you're a random dude in the middle of Wichita, no offense, but are hot girls throwing themselves at you at all times,
Probably not. I know I'm a random dude in the middle of L.A., and an odd girl's going to throw themselves at me. Mm-hmm. And you know, and even now, right, even now when we have a little higher profile, ain't nobody throwing themselves. Before, ain't nobody throwing themselves at me, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So, but if you're David Beckham or you're Brad Pitt, or, you know, you name it. It doesn't have to be just Brad Pitt. There's a million of those guys, and nonstop attractive women propositioning them. At some point, they will break.
Yeah, well, you know, the incredible thing about David Beckham is that he's had a long and seemingly happy relationship. I wish them all the happiness in the world. But you know, I feel like he's more of an anomaly, whereas a lot of people do experience temptation throughout their relationships. And look, I think it mostly has to do with, yes, opportunities, but also your satisfaction in the relationship, right? So, you know, people cheat for different reasons. I think that the reasons for cheating vary based on gender as well. You know, I think for women, you know, there's a lot of issues with, like, I don't know, how involved your partner is, whether or not you feel emotionally connected, whether or not he's, you know, responsive to your needs. Like, those are the kinds of things that might convince a woman that it's worth cheating. And with men, does she have tits? Like, okay, you know,
you whatever. You might be oversimplifying a little bit. Actually, one thing that leads...
I'm being unfair to men, but
okay.
Really.
One thing that leads men to cheat more, according to the studies, is their wife giving them enough... Validation, right? So that's both understandable and a little sad, right?
Mm-hmm.
But so they look for validation and they go cheat. That's very common, whether you're a celebrity or not a celebrity, or whether you're attractive or not attractive. And you don't have to be a celebrity or rich, by the way. That's just one out of the four studies. It's just, it makes sense, speaking from a probability perspective. If you're more attractive, you're more likely to get more opportunities, and hence likely to have shorter relationships and have ones that are more likely to break up. But also, there's one other thing that I found interesting. One of the first things you mentioned there, Anna, mm-hmm. decreased effort in relationship maintenance. So if you're hot, you think, like, I'm hot. I don't have to do anything here,
mm-hmm.
right? So I'm not going to bother putting much effort into this relationship. What's he going to do, break up with me? Are you kidding me? Or what's she going to do, break up with me? No, I'm hot,
yeah.
right? So, and it turns out, no, relationship maintenance is actually the most important thing.
It's very important. And that's, I mean, at least with marriage, I know, and I've only been married for a short time, that it takes work. It takes constant work, right? To remain involved in each other's lives and to keep the fire alive and all that stuff. Because we're humans, right? And you can only cook a steak so many times or so many ways. Like, sometimes you want some shrimp, right? Or, I don't know, lobster or something different. But you gotta, like, keep convincing yourself that you want steak. And that's maintenance. That's relationship maintenance.
I'm not sure that that's the only relationship maintenance or really the focus of this story. But I do see what's going on a little bit here.
By the way, anyway, now I'm going to stop myself before I get in trouble.
Okay.
I love steak, guys. Love it.
Okay. And look, maybe there's a slight counter effect, too, which
yeah.
is that if your partner is hotter, maybe you are more likely to stay with them. Right? At least they continue to
yeah.
be attractive to you, and so that's a slight upside. But overall, we now have the jury's in, so the slight downside to being attractive is, well, your relationships are more likely to end and end quicker.
Yeah.
Okay.
Can we edit out the part where I talked about steak and lobster?
No.
Okay.
No. Yes. We're going to do that. All right, one more story.
All right. A startup in Silicon Valley is actually offering to pay its employees $10,000 if they delocate, meaning if they move out of Silicon Valley. Now, this is actually really great news because the company, Zapier, does allow its employees to work remotely. And so, since they're not required to live in Silicon Valley, they want to encourage people to live wherever they want, and they get a $10,000 bonus as a result. Now, Zapier recently announced that if current Bay Area residents were interested in improving their family standard of living by relocating, the firm would provide $10,000 in moving reimbursements. Tech workers earning between $100,000 to $700,000 recently spoke to The Guardian about their real estate struggles, and one study suggested that for some engineers, more than 50% of their salary goes to rent. Now, I think this is actually something that a lot of Americans are experiencing. Financial advisors usually tell you, you shouldn't spend more than 30% of your income on where you're living, but a lot of people pay way more than that. And that's certainly the case in high-priced areas like Silicon Valley or Los Angeles or New York City. But I love this because it's kind of encouraging people to move away, and hopefully it will help lower, you know, the cost of the housing market there if more companies follow suit and do something similar.
Yeah, it's a weird hit that this guy's taken on his own to get people to move away from him.
Yeah.
Because a lot of companies would have to do this for it to have any kind of effect. This company only has 85 people.
Right.
So, and it doesn't really, if they're all working from home, which in his case they do, what does he care if they live near him or a million miles from him? But it like, a million miles from him doesn't help him any more than it hurts him. So
I think that this might be an effort to attract some of the more talented engineers and employees. And so I think a lot of people are deterred from working in Silicon Valley jobs if they have to live in the Bay Area. It's so incredibly expensive. And why would you want to go through, you know, making a decent living and not being able to enjoy it because all your money is going to go toward rent?
Yeah, so that makes sense. And it worked for him. Immediately, they had once he announced they had 150 applications, 50 of them specifically saying, hey, can I please move away from you? I like that idea a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and if he's looking to recruit better, mission accomplished. Really nice PR move and probably worth the extra $10,000 he's going to give in relocation for however many people that he's going to hire. Random part of the story that made me bitter and jealous is that the CEO is 30 years old.
I know, but that's the case with most, you know, successful CEOs in Silicon Valley. They're super young, in a lot of cases younger than us, and they're millionaires. I don't know if he's a millionaire, but yeah, it sucks. That's life.
No, it's good for you. God bless, yeah. Wade Foster, and well played on this effort, and it helps people in San Francisco, because let's just finish on that, because it is really mental that if you make $700,000 and you can't afford the rent, like, it's, we've gone beyond the middle class getting crunched.
I know.
Like, in places like San Francisco, it's not true in the middle of Kentucky, but in places like San Francisco, everybody's getting crunched.
I know. It's getting worse in Los Angeles as well. So, think about it.
Think about it. I don't know what I'm thinking about. I don't know what that has anything to do with me, but okay.
I mean, I can't work remotely. I could Skype in, do the show.
No, I'm not buying it. We do actually have a bunch of people who work remotely. Anyways, can I get the flag? Because I just want to add one last thing here. Not related to the story. I actually want to tell you something about the previous story we just did about the physical attractiveness.
Yeah.
So, there we go. Okay. Related to this story, I'm going to tell you in the post game about this crazy thing our high school did, mm-hmm. for the really attractive girls and guys in the class.
Mm-hmm.
We did a slave auction.
Jeez.
Oh, my God. Okay, so this was back in 1988. It was in New Jersey. What in the world was that slave auction?
Mm-hmm.
And why did we do it? And what were the ramifications? And did we think that it was a big deal or not? So I'll tell you that in the postgame for the members at tytnetwork.com/join. Become a member, get the whole show, get the post games, and you'll find out that story as well. All right.
Bye bye.
All right, go to bed.